Ooh, Lord, my trouble's so hard. Don't nobody know my trouble but God. Don't nobody know my trouble but God.
The biggest problem with the holodeck, or actually recreating humans, is that that's a very, very difficult problem. So there's something called light field technologies that allow you to volumetric capture the space. So for example, somebody over in San Francisco where I'm from could be sitting here where you are watching this. That's very, very difficult to do because human capture is hard, right? You got to get it basically exactly right. Otherwise, you feel this thing called the uncanny valley, right? Where something's almost human, but not quite. And there's sort of this revulsion that people have when they see something like that. But at the same time, on the flip side, I think in many ways the holodeck is here now in the sense that in VR, one of the biggest things I've learned and one of the things that we kind of have almost plastered on the walls as a principle is in VR, simplicity goes a long way. And when I first tried the early prototypes that was coming out of Oculus when I first joined, what was interesting is that you see, there was this one room where you basically saw an experience of yourself in a mirror and you were a cube, just a simple cube with two dots for eyes, and that was it. And basically you moved your head around and it followed your movement. And there was something really real about that, right? It wasn't human, it didn't look human, it was very simple and it was very powerful.
Il y a encore toute une jeunesse à former. Donc on a des liens avec des écoles de cinéma, et notamment avec l'école de cinéma de Marrakech, qui est une très bonne école, pour essayer aussi de former les Africains à fabriquer leurs propres histoires. Donc le travail d'Unifrance, vous voyez, est vraiment très large, puisqu'il va aussi jusqu'à des réflexions qu'on a menées d'ailleurs à travers un rapport qui est disponible sur notre site, hein, sur les opportunités en Afrique. Mais c'est vrai que c'est passionnant parce que c'est, vous voyez, toute la chaîne qui est concernée.
Le groupe MK2 a racheté un grand réseau en Espagne depuis 2 ans, dans le sud de l'Espagne, et que maintenant il passe de la VO sur des films étrangers, qui est un public cinéphilique et jeune espagnol qui va voir autre chose que les blockbusters. C'est aussi encourageant, et que MK2 veuille aussi, et c'est de nouveau confirmé, investir au Canada, là où il y a aussi un gros problème d'accès aux écrans pour les films autres qu'américains, y compris pour les films francophones du Québec. De voir MK2 qui a essayé sur une salle et du coup ils sont arrivés mais ils veulent le faire et créer et 2-3 spots comme ça à Montréal et ailleurs, c'est aussi encourageant et je crois que même le problème actuellement aux États-Unis de trouver une ou deux salles à New York pour trouver des films. Voilà.
In India, without a Salman Khan or Akshay Kumar involved, but presumably this all means nothing to a Chinese audience, and you're able to start again the story.
So, just to put it in a nicer way, apart from Amir Khan, who's also there's a lot of money we spent behind it, like because we distributed PK, and we literally had to spend a lot of money in terms of PNA to build even Amir Khan, who's the so-called biggest star, thanks to 3 idiots for leaving in China. Shahrukhs of the world, the Salmans of the world, or even the younger lot, they're absolutely nobody in China right now. So that gives a producer with a very good script, a very good movie, come up with a new star, and build it. Which is not going to happen in UK or US, where Indian diaspora is the audience. We don't have Indian diaspora in China.